This evening we have an Old Testament and a New Testament reading. The Old Testament reading you can find in the prophet Isaiah, chapter 53. The book of Isaiah, chapter 53. And the New Testament reading, the Gospel according to John, chapter 13, the verses 1 to 7 and 31 to 35. Gospel according to John. Chapter 13, the verses 1 to 7 and 31 to 35. And in response to the reading of God's holy word, we sing of Psalm 334, the stanzas 1 and 4. Thy word sheds light upon my path, a shining light. It guides my feet and what follows. The word of the Lord. Who has believed our report? And to whom is the arm of the Lord revealed? For he shall grow up before him as a tender plant and as a root out of a dry ground. He has no form nor comeliness, and we shall see him. There is no beauty that we should desire him. He is despised and rejected of men, a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief, and we hid, as it were, our faces from him. He was despised, and we esteemed him not. Surely he has borne our grief and carried our sorrows. Yet we did esteem him stricken, smitten of God, and afflicted. But he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him, and with his stripes we are healed. All we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned everyone to his own way, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. He was oppressed and he was afflicted, yet he opened not his mouth. He is brought as a lamb to the slaughter, and as sheep before the shearers is dumb, so he opened not his mouth. He was taken from prison and from judgment, and who shall declare his generation? For he was cut out of the land of the living. For the transgression of my people he was stricken. And he made his grave with the wicked, and the rich in his death, because he had done no violence. Neither was there any deceit in his mouth. Yes, it pleased the Lord to bruise him. He has put him to grief. When thou shalt make his soul an offering for sin, he shall see his seed. He shall prolong his days, and the pleasure of the Lord shall prosper in his hand. He shall see of the travail of his soul, and shall be satisfied. By his knowledge shall my righteous servant justify many, and he shall bear their iniquities. Therefore will I divide him a portion with the great, and he shall divide the spoil with the strong. Because he has poured out his soul unto death, and he was numbered with the transgressors, and he bare the sin of many, and made intercession for transgressors. The Gospel according to John, chapter 13, verse 1. Now before the feast of the Passover, when Jesus knew that his hour was come, that he should depart out of this world unto the Father, having loved his own which were in the world, he loved them unto the end. And supper being ended, the devil having now put in the heart of Judas Iscariot, Simon's son, to betray him. Jesus, knowing that the Father had given all things into his hand, and that he was come from God and went to God, he arose from supper and laid aside his garments and took a towel and girded himself. After that he poured water into the basin and began to wash the disciples' feet and to wipe them with the towel wherewith he was girded. Then he comes to Simon Peter, and Peter said to the Lord, "Dost thou wash my feet?" And Jesus entered and said to him, what I do thou knowest not now, but thou shalt know hereafter. And then we continue in verse 31 till the end. Therefore, when he was gone out, that is Judas, Jesus said, now is the Son of Man glorified, and God is glorified in him. If God be glorified in him, God shall also glorify him in himself, and shall straightway glorify him. Little children, yet a little while I am with you. You shall seek me. And as I said unto the Jews, whither I go, ye cannot come. So now I say to you. And this is the text for this night. A new commandment, says Christ, I have given unto you, that you love one another, as I have loved you, that ye also love one another. And by this shall all men know that ye are my disciples, if you have love one to another. Simon Peter said unto him, Lord, whither goest thou? And Jesus answered him, whither I go, thou canst not follow me now, but thou shalt follow me afterwards. Peter said unto him, Lord, why can I not follow thee now? I will lay down my life for thy sake. Jesus answered him, wilt thou lay down thy life for my sake? Verily, verily, I say unto thee, the cock shall not crow. Great awakening. And so most of us also here present, we are privileged, like in the time of Jonathan Edwards, privileged to hear Sunday after Sunday the proclamation and preaching of the word of Christ's love for sinners. Christ's love which marks and transforms the true Christian, even today, which in turn results in our love to him and our love to one another, to be united, to have fellowship, to love one another as Christ loved us first. That marks the Christian. A unity in Christ, a unity in diversity in the midst of the congregation, but loving one another. Friends, it is a mark of revival, of spiritual refreshment and renewal, personally, corporately, and as church community. When we have Lord's Supper in the midst of the congregation, are we not reminded that the forum says that we, by this same spirit, that revival spirit, may also be united as members of one body in true brotherly love, as the holy apostle said, for we being many are one bread and one body, for we are partakers of that one bread. For as out of many grains one meal is ground and one bread baked, and out of many berries being pressed together one wine flows and mixed itself together, so shall we all, who by a true faith are engrafted into Christ, being all together one body, through brotherly love for Christ's sake, our beloved Savior, who has so exceedingly loved us, and not only showed this in word, but also in the very deed towards one another. Oneness, unity, brotherly, sisterly love, in word and deed to one another. And so is the early church remembered, as a community of fellowship and charity and prayer. For example, Acts 2, and we heard it yesterday too, in all that believer together and had things in common, and they continually daily in one accord in the temple, and breaking bread from house to house, did eat meat with gladness and singleness of heart. And then with this result, and that is the hope also of these past couple days, when the Lord gave to all of us that attended the conference, when we saw a clear demonstration of hospitality and of fellowship, that we have this hope, friends, this prayer with this result, as in the early church, and the Lord added to the church daily. Is that your hope? That this week you will meet people in life and bring them to church, and the Lord will add them to the church, such should be saved. And so the early church, immediately following the New Testament, Testament times, was known not directly for its orthodoxy, but for its orthopraxis, the right living. As some of the church fathers point out, for example, Hermas repeatedly points out that the Christian duty is to take care of widows and orphans. Clement of Rome praised the hospitality and fellowship practiced in the church of Corinth. In his letter to Polycarpus, Ignatius of Antioch says that communities use their resources to ransom slaves. Constantine the Great supported the Church of Alexandria in its work by instituting distributing food to the poor. And so it was in the time of the Great Awakening. It resulted that people were banding together a common cause, the gospel of Christ, that people were united for gospel mission, taking up mission work and sending out missionaries, that people were united to work among the poor and sometimes destitute Native Americans, that there was more care in those times for the widows, that they established women ministries, Bible study groups. Friends, revival marks and shapes a Christian marked by the love of Christ and marked by the love towards one another. And that is what we find in the chapter that we have read together, the Gospel according to John. And with the help of the Lord, I want to meditate with you at the close of this conference, so to say, this Lord's Day, this first day of the week, with the words that we find in John chapter 13, verse 34. Where Christ says to each of us tonight, a new command I give unto you, that you love one another as I have loved you, that you also love one another. And the theme for tonight is revival unity to Christ love and by loving one another. In the first place, seeing Christ's love for and towards us, and in the second place, sharing of giving our love to one another. Congregation chapter 13 of the Gospel of John brings us just before the Passover season. Verse 1, we have read now before the feast of the Passover. It was a time of reviving what God had done for the Old Testament believer. His deliverance from Egypt, his setting free from a people that he called to himself. And so the Passion season reminds us and revives us by grace what Christ has done. It is a time that to direct our minds and hearts and affections to the cross of Christ, the ultimate sacrifice, the ultimate display of God's love for a lost world, lost people, such as you and me. And then the chapter opens with Christ washing the disciples' feet, the verses 1 to 17, what we have read, which is followed by the announcing of Judas' betrayal, the verses 18 to 30, and closes with a brief discourse of Christ to his disciples, particularly the verses 31 to 35. The section of that chapter that we find our words of this evening. Therefore, when he was gone out, that is, when Judas went out to betray him, but that is also when Christ knew that only moments were left with his disciples before his going to Gethsemane and Gabbatha and Golgotha. hours left of a life lived that you and I should have lived. Hours before he died a death you and I deserve. And in these final moments, in his farewell, he speaks to his disciples. It is like one of those moments when a loved one is in his or her final hours and speak to you, and speak mostly of what is most important to talk about. And so Christ, what he says here in these verses, in his final hours, in his farewell, they are very important for his disciples, for us. And immediately Christ points to the cross. Verse 31b. Now is the Son of Man glorified, and God is glorified in him. If God be glorified in him, God shall also glorify himself and shall straightway glorify him. Do you hear? Five times. Glorify. Christ is glorified. God is glorified. Glorified in him. In himself shall glorify him. What is Christ saying here? Now the Son of Man is glorified. God is glorified. Friends, it can be maybe a challenging concept. Eh? God is love, or God is merciful. He is long-suffering. He is of great patience. We may have some understanding of it, conceptualize it. But God, Christ, is glorified. Let me point to two aspects of glory, as we heard also this morning. First, it points to its great worth and value, its weightiness. For example, in the parable of the great treasure in Matthew 13, the man assessed its value so great that he sold everything that he had. Everything else was pale compared to this great treasure, the great worth and value of the kingdom of heaven. But friends, glory points also to beauty and brilliance. And so the Apostle Paul writes in the second epistle to the Corinthians, chapter 3, noting the face of Moses for the glory of his countenance. And the original, the word in the original used here is doxa, doxology, glory, beauty, brilliance. Thus glory points to the great worth, majesty, value, beauty, and brilliance. Something that is of infinite value, more value to you than anything else. And now is the Son of Man glorified, and God is glorified in him. But Christ speaks of the cross. God's glory, Christ's glory, God's glory in Christ is revealed on the cross. Who can fathom this, comprehend this, grasp this? Christ, who left the place of heavenly glory, but emptied himself by taking the form of a servant, being born in the likeness of men and being found in human form. He humbled himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, even the death of the cross, to display his glory. It is so contrary what we expect. Elizabeth II of England, when she became queen in 1952, unexpectedly, maybe some of you have seen the documentary, or if you will, the movie, one of the first seasons, The Crown. When she was traveling in Africa and her father, the king, died, passed away, in that moment she became queen. And people bowed deeply. She was so She was so regal, so beauty, brilliance, and such words, such power, greatness as the queen. Your majesty. But when the King of Kings came, laying aside his heavenly glory, wrapped himself in the form of a servant, became like us, the likeness of men, had no form, no comeliness, so we have read from Isaiah 53. And you and I by nature, there is no beauty that we should desire him. He was despised, rejected of men, you and me. And we hid, as it were, our faces from him. He was despised and we esteemed him not. Or by grace, you have bowed down before him at the cross. With all your sins and shortcomings, with all your faults and flaws, seeing the infinite worth, value, beauty of Christ. Where are you? Have you come? He humbled himself. We have read it, eh? He bore our grief. What a gospel. What a gospel, friends. He carried our sorrows. Whatever sorrow you have brought into church this evening. Seeing Christ, he carried my sorrows. Pierced for our transgression. Crushed for our iniquities. Becoming obedient to the point of that even the death on the cross. Yesterday I heard someone said, yeah, in his passive and active obedience. Yes, yes. In his obedience to his Father. He is a complete Savior, friends. In his passive obedience, meaning Christ took the penalty his people deserved. And he died the death his people should have died. Died the death. Pause for a moment. That you and I deserve and should have died. In his active obedience, meaning Christ lived the life his people should have lived, lived a life that I should have lived, he kept all of God's commandments and lived them, who truly could say, I delight to do thy will, O my God, thy law is within my heart. And now seeing the glory of the cross, seeing Christ's love, Christ self-denying, Christ sacrificial love. Edward says at various places in his sermons that seeing Christ on the cross, that there are moments that there is joy and delight, comfort and peace, hope and confidence, a foundation and a resting place, an ark and a refuge, a food and the medicine for the soul, also for your soul. Not to think what you have done and must do. Not to meditate on your own goodness and your own righteousness. But to love, to think what Christ has done. His suffering, his death, his righteousness, his blood, his finished and complete work. Is that not the reason why you came to church today? I don't think you did come to church to testify that you are perfect and righteous as in yourself. But on the contrary, considering that you seek your life out of yourself in Jesus Christ. Maybe despite the many infirmities and miseries in yourself, having not a perfect faith and not giving yourself to serve God with that zeal as you are bound to, and have daily to strive with the weakness of your faith and the evil lust of your flesh, and yet, and that is also experienced by grace, you cannot deny, since you are by the grace of the Holy Spirit, that reviving, that regenerating, that refreshing Holy Spirit, that you are sorry for these weaknesses and have an earnest desire to fight against your unbelief and doubts and to live according to all the commandments in God. Looking unto Christ, your only refuge, looking to the glory of the cross. That is the love poured out in your heart, which marks a Christian. May I ask you tonight, is that you? Is that you? Because, friends, maybe many of us have grown up in church. You may know a great and good deal about Christ by a kind of head knowledge. You may know who he was, where he was born, and what he did. You may know his miracles, his sayings, his prophecies, and his ordinances. You may know how he lived, how he suffered, how he died. But unless you know the power of Christ's cross by experience, unless you know and feel within that the bloodshed on that cross has washed away your sin, unless you are willing to confess that your salvation depends entirely on the work that Christ did upon the cross, unless this be the case, Christ has no benefit to you. Friends, the mere knowing of Christ's name will never save you. You must know his cross and his blood, or else you will die in your sin. That is the wonder of his grace in the preaching also today. Despite who I am, despite my struggles and strifes, but you cannot miss him anymore. To the King will I go. If I perish to the cross, I will go. Because when you have heard the voice of my beloved, behold, he comes, leaping over the mountains, bounding over the hills. I will seek him whom my soul loves, and then to be received in God's mercy for Christ's sake. Remember, be encouraged, be strengthened amidst the struggles and strifes, the challenges and cares and concerns of life. Be admonished and assured of this, says Christ, of this my hearty love and faithfulness towards you. And he does it from the cross. Seeing so Christ in his infinite worth, value and beauty, and that over against my sin and my shortcoming and the ugliness of myself, then it is so fittingly to read the administration of the form of the Lord's Supper. And I'm not your pastor, but I think he will agree with me. Don't do it just with Lord's Supper. Read it time and again. Read it time and again. And then to read that where Christ was bound, that you might be freed from our sin. Where he suffered innumerable reproaches, that you be never confounded. Where he was innocently put to death, that you are acquitted at the judgment seat of God. Where he suffered his blessed body to be nailed to the cross, that he might fix thereon the handwriting of your sin. That he also has taken upon himself the curse due to us, that he might fill us with his blessings. And when he cried out with a loud voice, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? So that you might be accepted of God and never be forsaken of him. We have heard it this night in the scripture reading, eh? And he loved them to the end. Greater love has no man than this, that a man lays down his life for his friends. For his friends. Failing friends sinning friends, friends that were enemies. That is Christ. And that was displayed in sacrificial love on the cross. This place demonstrated, shown in the preaching of the word, time and again, God's love in Christ. Christ's love for sinners. Friends, it unites heaven and earth, a sinner and Savior. This man, the Son of Man, Christ receives sinners and eats with them. And Christ, facing his final suffering, the cross and death, says to his friends, a new commandment I give to you, that you love one another as I have loved you, that you also love one another. And therefore, in the second place, seeing his great love for his people, to a people like you and me, does he now ask too much to keep this love commandment, to keep this new commandment for Christ's sake, for his sacrificial and self-denying love? And he asks you and me tonight, as I have loved you, that you also love one another. Should that not unite us? And the commandment to love one another is found in the Old Testament. It's not new. And moreover, in Adam and with God's covenant people of old, we have not kept his commandments and none of his commandments. So what is then new in what Christ asked his disciples? Well, this is new. Christ said, as I have loved you. That makes it new. Seeing his infinite love. Seeing his sacrificial love. Seeing the depth of his love. What it cost him. Friends, meditate upon that. Take time in your busy schedules, even this week, and see the depth of Christ's love by the greatness of what it cost him. See the depth of his love for a people like you and me, and how little and none that we deserve of it. The more undeserving we are, the more amazing and deep is his love for us. Seeing the depth of Christ's love for us, by the greatness of the benefits we received in being loved. Let me illustrate that if we are helped to pass an exam, young people, we feel maybe loved in one way. And if we are helped to get a job, we feel loved in another way. But if you are now rescued from eternal torment and given a place in the presence of God with fullness of joy and pleasures forevermore, we will know the depth of love that surpasses all others, seeing what kind of love the Father is giving to us in Christ, that we should be called children of God, not children of wrath. That is the gospel. Love is deep in proportion to its liberty, so I recently read. Meaning, if an insurance company pays you, say, $2,000 because you have wrecked your car, you don't usually marvel at how much this company loves you. But if the church makes all your meals for a month after you have lost a loved one, or someone calls you every day because you go through a difficult time, or visit you every week, then you call it love, because they don't have to do this. It is free and unwilling. And so it is, seeing the depth of Christ's love for us in his freedom. He was not obliged to do it. Therefore, does my Father love me, because I lay down my life that I may take it again. And no man taketh it from me, but I lay it down of myself. And therefore does the Lord ask us too much? And all God's people, what the apostle says, therefore be imitators of God as beloved children and walk in love, just as Christ also loved you and gave himself up for us, an offering and a sacrifice to God as a fragrant aroma. Do you imitate him? Do you imitate him also this week? Him who loved you with an everlasting love. With an everlasting love, with a sacrificial love. When he invites to come to him, who revives you, who refreshes you, giving you food through his word to the weary and the weak on the way, who gives you drink through the sacraments, reminding you of the blood of Christ that cleanses of all your sin. Sins of the past you don't want to talk about. Friends, it is not necessary anymore. In Christ it is forgiven and forgotten. Sins of the present you struggle with, they are covered with his blood. Sins of the future, they have been covered and paid for by his blood. Through him who gave himself up for us, an offering and a sacrifice to God as a fragrant aroma. Does he ask then us too much tonight to be a fragrant aroma as a church community, pleasing and sweet and radiant, inviting community? Is it seen in the church, as we have seen in this last couple of days, the way of fellowship, the unity, yes, in all its diversity? Because each member has gifts differing from one another, but unity, that you love one another. Remember, says Christ, as I have loved you. And if you cannot deny that in your life, as I have loved you, that you also love one another. Friends, also for this new week, do we have a servant attitude? Eh? Christ emptied himself by taking the form of a servant, supremely loved by his Father. And he left heaven for earth to bring us from earth to heaven to himself. Are we truly servants? Serving one another and those around us and come in contact with? He who was born in our likeness, Do we see the people that we meet, even this week, a homeless one, a single struggling divorced man or woman, a deformed person, someone that is hurt or has anger, a white, a black, a yellow, whatever skin color, a lesbian, a gay, do we see created in God's image? Not any better than you and me. In need of salvation, in need of Christ, the Savior, as we need it as well. Do we as church community carry the sorrows of others? Share in the grief of those around us? Christ humbled himself, takes the lowest place. We have seen it in the first 17 verses. Jesus washed the feet of the disciples, an explicit example for what he came for. It did not come to be served, but to serve. Christ says in verse 15, I have given you an example that you also should do just as I have done to you. Is it not so that the only people suitable to represent Jesus here on earth are the lowly, the humble, the servant-like, the self-denying people? It is that Christ, as it were, says, if you realize what I am saying, if you understand who I am, and what a privilege is it to be called to represent me, to serve me, with me, you will be glad. You will find your deepest joy in life. Not when the people are hailing you because of your status, but when they are helped by you in your service. And therefore, friends, there is no room, nor should be there any room for self-promotion. Hey, if you read the business magazines, for example, Forbes, they identify self-promotion as leadership skill. But friends, what is needed is servant leadership with Christ-like humility. Seeing what Christ has done for you and loves you. Amazing. Servant leadership. It enriches the lives of those around you. It builds better organizations, congregations, seminaries, Bible schools, churches. And it creates a more just and caring world and society. Remember, the Lord does not ask us to do great things. But even in the small things of life, that we do it with great love. And whosoever will be great among you, let him be your minister. Must be your servant. That is the radical call of the gospel. But to be served by Jesus as we serve others. And therefore should not Christ's sacrificial love, his glory on the cross, transform us, revive us at the close of this conference, the beginning of this new week, to be imitators of him and to live out of him. And with this new commandment, what he has done, what you never could and can do, and therefore as he loved you, that you also love one another. And in this way, moreover, to be a means and a testimony of grace, a missionary means, an evangelistic means of God's work. As Christ reminds us in the subsequent words of the text, verse 35, by this shall all men know that you are my disciples, if you have love one to another. Friends, do your neighbor next door know that you are a follower of Christ? Christ prays to his Father in chapter 17 of the Gospel according to John, that they all may be one as thou, O Father, art in me and I in thee, that they also may be one in us, that the world in which we live, the world from this week, the world of school and university and work, the world may believe that thou hast sent me. Does the world around us here in New Jersey believe that Christ was sent by the Father? Does the world in which we work and go to school believe in Christ because we are one? One in Christ? If the world would look inside this building on a Sunday morning or a Sunday evening, do they see the compelling love for one another? Not coldness or stiffness or infighting. Or would they walk away? And love is the ultimate apologetics. Who can resist love as Christ has loved us? Love binds together. I think it was Dr. Martin Lloyd-Jones. He once worked in the high echelon of the British society in a famous hospital in London. And after a couple of years, he sensed a calling to preach, and he returned to Wales, beginning to serve a very small congregation in Wales. And while serving in this small, poor fishing village, there was a voice inside that asked him, "Are you a Christian?" Maybe you know this question. And he wrestled and he wrestled and he wrestled. Until he saw and said to the voice, "There is more joy being among God's people in this little village than among the elite without God in London. There is more joy." A love that binds and unites God's people together in Christ. And that stopped the voice. "I am a companion of all them that fear thee." A new commandment I give to you, that you love one another as I have loved you, that you also love one another. And these words, as recorded in chapter 13, are remembered by the Apostle John years later, as he remembered Jesus' words spoken the feast of the Passover, as they had eaten together. He writes years later in 1 John 3, and this is how we should remember and practice Christ's words. John writes, "For this is the message that you have heard from the beginning, that we should love one another. But this we know, love, that he laid down his life for us. And so we ought to lay down our life for the brothers, for the sisters. But if anyone has the world's good and sees his brother in need, yet closes his heart against him, how does the love of God abide in him?" And then he said, little children, congregation of Kinnelon, brothers and sisters in Christ, and that such might be the outcome of the conference of this weekend. Little children, let us not love in word or talk, but in deed and in truth. So that by the end of your life, you may say by grace for Christ's sake, the words that Christ prayed at the end of his life, "I have glorified thee on earth. I have finished the work thou hast given me to do." And then to hear Christ say to you on the day of judgment, when you stand before him, "Come, you are blessed of my Father. Inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world." For, and now we seek practical Christianity, the practice of godliness, the fruit of revival. When Christ says to you, it will be something. "I was hungry and you gave me food. I was thirsty and you gave me drink. I was a stranger and you welcomed me. I was naked and you clothed me. I was sick and you visited me. I was in prison and you came to me." And then you will say and answer him, saying, "Lord, when did we see you hungry and feed you and thirsty and give you to drink? And when did we see a stranger and welcomed you and naked and clothed you? And when did we see you sick and imprisoned and visited you?" And then the King in his glory will answer you, "Truly I say to you, as you did it to one of the least of these my brothers, you did it to me." What a day that will be. Love one another as he has loved you. Loved with an everlasting love. Amen. Let us pray. Lord, what a day will that be when the fruits of revival, when the fruits of thy work will be displayed for the world before thy throne in glory. And we pray and plead with thee that that will be the outcome of our conference and also this day to the preaching of thy word this morning and this afternoon. To hear from thy lips, "Truly I say to you, you did it to the least of this, my brothers, and you did it to me." Lord, will bless thy word richly to each and every one of us, that Christ might be exalted and continue to be exalted in this community, to be a testimony of thy grace in here in New Jersey. And that thou, the Lord, will add daily to those that will be saved. Lord, our hope, our revival hope is in thee, the Lord Jesus Christ, in whose name we pray. Amen. Friends, we close with the singing of Psalter 371, the stanzas 1 and 2, behold how pleasant and